If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, for the first 20 minutes or so, we have some fun conversation. We talk about mental health.
We always have fun, Sal.
And physical health. And are they separate or are they the same thing? It's all one. We talk about ketones versus glucose, the benefits of each.
Which one does your body run better on?
Exactly. And then we talk about the increases of antidepressant use. I also mentioned Thrive
all
Market.
All them Adderall lovers out there.
Exactly. I also mentioned Thrive Market in this episode. Don't forget, you can go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump and get a bunch of free stuff. Free membership, $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and free shipping.
That's right. They love you.
They do. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, what is the proper way to bulk up? Is there a more effective way? Is there a less effective way? How do we recommend you do it?
Pizza bulking.
The second question is, how do you read studies? In other words, what do you look for? How do you determine if the studies are credible and if you should take them seriously?
I deferred this one to Sal.
Yeah, like red wine burns body fat. No, it doesn't. Next question was about cardio. We talk about it in terms of if you overdo it, it may sacrifice longevity. This particular person is saying, well, if that's true, then why do we see these 60-year-old triathletes who are just kicking ass?
Yeah, yeah. Do you want to look like a skinny raisin? Ask yourself that.
Exactly.
My telomeres are telling me other things.
I think he just wanted to use telomeres.
Yeah, telomeres.
I think that's what that was.
And finally, what are the top five most functional lifts? We have a little debate about that, but I think at the end we have a consensus. Also, MAPS Anabolic, it's our foundational program. It includes trigger sessions. Now, you don't find the trigger session concept almost in any other program. It's extremely effective.
Unless it's being copied.
It's the program that kind of got us our start. If you haven't done any of our programs, this is the place to get started. It is excellent for building strength, building muscle. It's a three-phased workout. It's
3 days a week.
It's about 9 weeks long, not counting pre-phase. If you count pre-phase, about 12 weeks long. Extremely effective. You can find it at mindpumpmedia.com.
Don't forget, too, all the programs have a 30-day money-back guarantee also.
That's right. I did want to talk to you guys about something kind of interesting. When we met with Rob Wolf, then we had Chris Kresser here, which we don't know when his episode's going to air, if it was before this one or after. But anyway, Chris Kresser, brilliant guy in the world of functional medicine and wellness.
Oh, yeah.
And we're talking about this silent epidemic, the mental health epidemic that's exploding, that's crazy. And it completely mirrors the physical health epidemic. Like, we know now how poor health contributes to anxiety, depression, ADHD, you know, all these mental disorders, even...
Right. And then we're medicating on top of that, and we're getting all the symptoms as resulting from that as well.
Well, but besides that, we have this explosion in poor health. Of course, we're going to have this explosion in poor mental health. So I looked up some statistics. This is going to blow you guys away.
Well, is this from the study he sent over to you, or is this something totally
different? No. So that spurred it, because he did send me a study. So the study that he showed me was that people with... autoimmune inflammatory disorders like irritable bowel syndrome or multiple sclerosis are at much, much, much higher risk for mental disorders like depression or anxiety. And that's an obvious connection, especially now that we have studies that show how inflammation contributes to those and how poor gut health contributes to those and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just incredible how we try to separate the two when they're actually both, they're one and the same. Health is health.
Right.
And so I looked up some statistics. I said, okay, we know physical health is gone to shit. And it's just getting, it seems to be getting worse in many, many ways. Let's look at statistics for antidepressant prescriptions for
in regards to
anti-anxiety.
What?
How many prescriptions are being put out? How many people are diagnosed now with depression, anxiety?
Well, when my wife went in to get for a thyroid, you know, and her thyroid was low, so they're prescribing right away. They wanted to give her an antidepressant. That was the first thing, just because they could treat something right
off of her thyroid.
Yeah,
that was the next. That was the go-to.
Because
was
the symptoms, because her symptoms presented themselves in a common way that many times you don't have necessarily something measurable. Although she did have low thyroid, so that was the remedy.
Right.
But yeah, you're right. That's like the first line of defense. But my point is, mental illnesses are exploding in this country, and suicide is at all-time highs in most age groups. Suicide. Well, all this stuff is and we're like we're living in a time where things are
we're not combining that at all.
Like nobody's
thought process.
Everybody
like,
thinks the mental part. Yeah, but is I separate think that
that's all genetic.
Part.
What's hard is you have to tease out everything, right? You have to tease out that you know our population is increasing at a rapid rate. Then you bring in the stuff that, and I know people are probably
it's a percentage of population, so that wouldn't matter.
Oh, it was a percentage. It's not person. You're not
that's not total numbers.
Okay, so percentage.
Yes.
So that does tease that out. But then you have to take into account other factors that I think actually play into this also, which is like social media.
Yep.
10 years now, we have that's all we have of this data of all these people, you know, posting pictures of themselves and getting likes or not getting likes and the, oh my God, nobody likes me type of bullshit. Like that didn't exist.
It exaggerates.
That didn't exist 15 years ago. When we were kids, it wasn't like that. Like if you were sad and depressed because you didn't have friends because nobody knocked on your door and no one wanted to play with you or you were picked last. Like that was it. Like there wasn't like, I wasn't just getting this constantly bombarded with, oh, I don't feel good about myself.
Yeah, because your social status. Right, in check like constantly.
So that's what I thought too. And I would definitely bet that social media plays a role. We don't have enough data yet because it hasn't been around long enough yet. Mm. But I would definitely bet, if I were to bet money, I would bet it does. Although science has an interesting way of proving us wrong, right? However, if you look at the growth of diagnosis of these mental disorders, it's been growing since the obesity epidemic began. So way before social media exploded, you see this rise 80s, 90s, early 2000s. That's continued rise. So it's not like we saw this kind of constant amount and then this jump.
Well, then the debate with that would then be just the awareness of it and then people sharing it and we're now familiar with it. Because go back another 20 years or 30 years before that and it was something that we didn't even diagnose,
well,
right?
Well, suicides are up too in all age groups. Right. If I look at the whole thing, I think there's a lot of factors that you can speculate. But the one that I think is pretty guaranteed, at least for me, and the science show this, although a lot of people don't talk about this, is if your physical health is poor, you're probably not going to have great mental health, or at least your odds of having poor mental health are much higher. It's interesting to me that this is even a debate with a lot of people. We have studies that show that exercise and nutrition are as effective or more effective than antidepressants for treating mild to moderate depression. That's already established.
Well, and this goes back to what we talked about before too, that a lot of people think they feel good because they don't know what great feels like, or they've never felt their body at optimal and what it feels like. So even those that are running around that maybe carrying themselves 20, 30, 40 pounds overweight and eating whatever the fuck they want, and they feel like, oh, I'm totally fine, I don't feel like I'm not healthy, but that's because they've never actually cleaned up everything. They don't know what their brain feels like or their body feels like when it's running optimally. And you know, even speaking from experience, I remember when, you know, we went through the whole ketogenic process, and for the first time in my life, I was eating under 100 grams of carbs on a daily basis, and it was a significant difference in my cognitive function. I mean, I could tell when we would podcast like this. Like it's you know, we'd talk on this goddamn thing all the time, and you know, we're talking about all kinds of topics and subjects, and we're recalling studies and remembering information that I fucking learned years ago and stuff. And when I'm lower carb, higher fat diet, I'm way sharper than when I am. And I've played with this multiple times where I'd be like, oh, let me introduce another 200-300 grams.
That's what I found from fasting. Same thing. Right. Yeah, so much sharper as a result of that. And once you got through the actual, you know, hurdles of, you know, learning how to navigate in that situation and what real hunger actually feels like, and then when I actually need food and when it's going to benefit me the most.
So did you know there's some recent studies now that are showing that a ketogenic type diet can help treat or can be used as a treatment for anxiety and mild depression?
Yeah. They're actually that makes sense. Yeah.
They're actually showing now that exactly what you said. Now that I want to be clear, it's not the answer to everything. I think it may be good for a lot of people, and I think when people are in a study like that,
it's not going to hurt people to try it.
Well,
though,
what know? I think That's is when you're in a study like that, they probably went in with a shitty diet, and so yes, it was keto, but it was also probably an improvement.
Right, you have to unpack that, right? Like, it's not the fact that it's the ketogenic diet that it's now making these people feel better or less depressed. It's probably the overconsumption of processed foods and sugar and carbohydrates, and then the switching over to probably more whole foods, mm-hmm. higher good healthy fats, and that it's really not the diet. I think that's what we were always trying to get that message across, that it's not this such thing as a magical diet that's going to make a person feel this way, but there are characteristics that are that come from a ketogenic diet, which is eating a higher
ketones fat. Like feel what that feels like. A lot of people don't understand, like, you know, in your brain, like, really, like, it thrives with ketones. Like,
isn't
it's interesting
it does. It's on that topic of running on ketones versus like glucose, you know, it's funny to me. Like, I prefer glucose if I'm like an athlete. Like, if I was always playing sports, like, I wasn't
there. Young. It's immediate,
right? Yeah. And but as an older adult who doesn't play sports every day of his life anymore, I prefer running on ketones. Mm-hmm. You know, for mental clarity purposes, satiety. You know, no cravings, things like that. It just seems like the body operates on that system better. And then if you're an athlete, then
it seems more efficient. Yeah,
right.
Yeah, but like if you're trying to be explosive or like do things like sprinting or, you know, that, then obviously, like, for me, like, glucose makes a lot more sense.
Well, exogenous ketones are, I've used them as a nootropic, so I'll supplement with them sometimes if I want to be more sharp, and I'll take the exogenous ketones and I'll take it with like another natural nootropic, or I'll combine it with like the, you know, like Chimera coffee that's got the nootropics in it.
Yeah, you're the only one that's been really experimenting with the exogenous ketones, right? Have you done any of that, Adam?
I've taken them like twice.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a big fan. You know, who was it we just recently discussed this
Rob
with?
Wolf.
Was it Rob Wolf? Yeah. You know,
he made some good points. You know, he talked about, like, here you've got the exogenous ketone supplements. You take them, so they do raise your ketone levels in your body. So now you do have ketones, but people are taking this who also have adequate glycogen and you know, carbohydrates in their system.
It's still in their system.
So now
sending two different signals.
Not only are you sending two different signals, but the only time a human body will have high levels of both ketones and, you know, carbohydrates or glycogen present is in ketoacidosis, when they're diabetic and they're not, you know, it's in an unhealthy state.
Yeah, it's unhealthy.
Yeah, it's, otherwise it doesn't happen in nature. You don't get ketones unless you run out of glycogen or ketones.
And not to mention, too, we're splitting hairs here, too. Like, to me, and it's expensive-ass fucking supplement.
Yeah, it is, man.
Those things are like 50, 60 it's bucks like a CBD. Pop for like a...
Remember how much CBD we were looking into that?
Dude, it's just... Yeah, no, it's just... Exactly. No, it's a great example. CBD is another one that we promote, talk about, because of the benefits that we have found. I mean, we just had an episode where we discussed about the health benefits behind marijuana. But, you know, of course, what we're going to do is we'll take a little bit of that science and good information. We're going to package it into a supplement, wrap everything around it, make it sound like it's a fucking miracle supplement,
magic,
and charge you $60 to take this fucking CBD with it. And it's just like, that's ridiculous. Like, for the amount of advantage that you're getting for that, unless, like we talked about earlier, if this was somebody who's got cancer, or it's like, then at all costs, I'm trying everything I possibly can. But for the everyday person who's trying to use ketones for better performance or fat loss, or it's like, come on, you're splitting hairs. Mm-hmm. I would much rather invest that money in something else that is going to benefit you long term.
So I got some statistics here for you based on what we were talking about earlier with you know, mental health disorders. So from 1999 till 2014, there's been a 65% increase.
Wow, 65?
In the amount of people using antidepressants. So huge jump.
65%?
Increase, right?
Fuck.
Huge jump.
Now, There's two sides to that too, right? Because that could be the over pushing from the fucking medical side too.
Agreed.
Because it's easy, it's more accepted, because it's already going. So then they're pushing it on top of it. It's quick, easy.
It's a condition they can treat,
right? Yeah. Real quick. Yeah. So
I agree.
And we probably know they're addictive. So it's just like a drug dealer.
Well, I mean, they're not necessarily addictive, but they will have dangerous withdrawal symptoms when you go off of them.
But that's addictive, but, motherfucker.
Yeah.
That's fucking addictive.
So here's the thing. When you look at countries who have this kind of poor health epidemic, you see the similar type of pattern. Although the U.S. kills everybody in per capita prescription drugs. I mean, it's incredible. We are one of the most.
We're the biggest drug dealer in the world, bro.
Yeah, by far.
100%. We're the biggest drug
dealer.
Here's
some more statistics. Adults between 20 and 44, the prescriptions of ADHD medication and anti-anxiety medications has increased 30%. So that's gone through the roof as well. So basically, across the board, these psychiatric medications have exploded. And the diagnosis have exploded. And I think we're in the middle of a health epidemic that encompasses everything, not just physical health. And I don't know about you guys, but you know, I've been training for 20 years. I don't remember as many clients telling me that they're on these medications or mm-hmm. suffering from anxiety like now. Like now, it's normal.
Yeah, anxiety is everywhere.
It's normal. Yeah. When I talk to a client, like 9 out of 10 times, that is something that they want to work on. It wasn't ever really an, I don't remember.
Well, there's just so many factors that contribute to that, you know, besides the, like the poor nutrition, the poor, you know, stress and all this stuff, like just being connected all the time on your phone and just not being able to unplug. And, you know, we talked about this and had people on the show that, you know, that have highlighted the addictive properties and just like how real that is and how like we're just bombarded. We're overstimulated.
Do you think part of it though is just that it's become more accepted? And so that's part of why it's just like, oh, it's the norm. It's like, oh, yeah. You know, Susie and Tommy and so-and-so, they take,
well, I'm communicating.
They
so,
take Adderall, you know, and they take this. Like, yeah.
It's, I definitely think that's part of it because as it becomes more, less taboo, then more people are willing to ask for it and then so on.
Cause when I was a kid, that didn't even exist. Like that wasn't even in school. Like
you didn't talk about it. At least
nobody I knew. I didn't know any kids when I was in high school.
Well, I think if they
below,
had it, they wouldn't have talked about it. That's
well,
for sure.
Oh, you think so? If it was your prescription that you were getting, it was more you're embarrassed about it or whatever?
Because kids have been getting prescribed.
Yeah, back in the day.
No, it has been, but not like where it's, I mean, so you got to go back. I mean, I remember that's 15 plus years ago for me, right? So that's over 15 years ago, that was not normal whatsoever. It wasn't until like maybe watching my younger siblings go through school and stuff like that, did you hear kids, you know, taking fucking Adderall and all your other, and what's the other, Ritalin and all these other drugs to, you know, so they could study all night long and stay up like that. I wasn't introduced to any of that shit.
Yeah.
I wish I would have. I mean, I probably would have done even
taking
better at
statins for performance. Yeah.
Would have been at least a 3.5 or a fucking 4.0.
Doctor.
Like yeah. 100, 100, 100, I would have been stuck on this goddamn podcast with you motherfuckers. That's for sure.
You'd have been
like a PhD something.
You'd have been a plastic
supplement
surgeon.
But I mean, again, I think this, to me, the scary part about that stuff is, you know, anybody that has dabbled with Adderall or Ritalin and you know what it's, I mean, fuck bro, it's like the best cup of coffee you've ever had in your life. And you know, if you're a kid who's trying to study and work,
bro, the base molecule is, I mean, like methamphetamine. It's a methamphetamine drug. It's legal. That's the only difference.
It's legal, it's legal crack is what it is. And you know, you get your hands on that at a very young age. Talk about what that's setting you up for long term.
Like, well, I mean, besides the psychological dependence, you have a developing brain, which your brain is plastic. In other words, it reacts to its environment and your nutrition and stuff, and that'll direct how it develops and where it's going to, you know, develop more connections or where it's going to have less connections. So you can't tell me that taking a psychiatric drug isn't going to affect that in some way. And of course, there's definitely people out there that need these, you know, these substances, these drugs. But I don't think it's, number one, I don't think it's as many as we think. But number two, I do think that because our health is worse, because our gut biomes are so off and that gets passed on generation to generation. Because they do find from generation to generation, the gut microbiome becomes less diverse each time. Because you get a lot of your fingerprint from your mom.
Yeah.
And so if hers is worse, then yours is going to be worse. And then, you know, if your girl has kids and...
You know, I was thinking about that as far as like, you know how they're coming in for like stem cell and all that stuff and they're gathering all this for like further science like down the road. Like, I was wondering about that as far as like the microbiome. Like if somebody were to kind of have like really quality microbiome that they swab, you know, with a newborn to set them up, you know, even better.
The hard part is like we don't even know what a quality microbiome is.
Well, we don't know it yet. I'm saying down in the future.
Like, for sure.
Yeah.
For you know what I mean? 100% when they figure this out, we are going to see medications where it's specific bacteria for specific things. Oh, you have, and I'm not even exaggerating.
Well, they're already somewhat playing with that when they swipe the mom's vaginal canal after a C-section, right? I mean, you're basically putting bacteria into their system or their mouth.
Yeah,
so
but what I'm talking about is, and you mark my words, this is going to happen.
Thank God
medicine.
We don't remember that.
Yeah,
you know what I mean,
this is going to happen in medicine. They are going to make specific
Did you have this weird? Or do those kids
is that like imprinted in your head somewhere?
Or do those kids have a weird fucking relationship with their mothers, you know what I'm saying? Like they could be. Has anyone done a study on that yet? I don't know. That's something that I haven't. Geez. How long have they been doing that for?
Has anybody done a study on that?
Well, it wasn't that long ago. I mean, C-sections were like a dime a dozen not that long ago. Then we found out that it was, what was the percentage of kids that were born with autism that went through C-sections? It was...
Well, it's just higher rates
much
of
higher
allergies and all kinds of
everything,
things,
right? So, and then, but how long ago was that? It wasn't 10 years ago, was it?
No.
So we don't know. There's always a cause and effect to everything. Yeah. So we might have fixed the allergies, but now you have this weird sexual addiction to mothers.
Wow. No, dude. Yeah. First of all, if you're born naturally, you come through her vagina.
That's why all that's on you porn.
Well, yeah, swab, I get it now. Coming through mom's vagina and getting it swabbed in your mouth are like two different things.
Not really, dude. Not really. I got an idea. Hey, yo, would you rather me swab my toe and put it in your mouth, or you want me to put my whole foot
gross,
up in your mouth?
Come on, man. Like, let's clean it up in here. Yeah, I want to talk about that.
Anyway.
Making Justin feel uncomfortable.
Anyway, what
I was going to say is they're going to design specific medications of specific strains for particular ailments, including mental ailments. Mark my words. You will see here, take this probiotic for depression, for anxiety, for whatever, and people are going to be taking them. That's going to be a huge part of medicine in the future.
The question that I have with that then is it better for us to use probiotics like that to kind of create this healthy bacteria, or is it better to, again, address lifestyle, eating habits, things like that promote a healthier gut?
I don't think in many cases we're not going to have a choice.
Yeah.
That's the problem. Well, you know what I mean? I think that's going to be the problem. It's going to be like a...
What do you mean? I think we'll always have the choice. I think the way our lifestyles are going, we are 100% heading in that direction, because that's still better than the route we're going right now, right? So I agree with you on that. But then you have to ask yourself, like, I could see it being not as good for us than it would be to change behaviors, habits, not go through certain.
Ideally, both, right?
Right, yeah. Right. Or
just the lifestyle.
Yeah, right. I think it'll always go back.
Overhaul.
I think it'll always go back. Even, remember when I told you guys I started supplementing with vitamin D after you shared the Harvard study with me, right?
He likes the D.
Yeah, that's right.
He's the one.
Yeah. Yeah, it is, right? So after that, like, then it kind of dawned on me, like, well, when I really noticed this happen was when I started working in gyms. I mean, I was literally born, like, taking in the sun all day. From sun up, sun down, I was in the sun, to the point where I had a really, really dark complexion. And it wasn't until I was in my 20s when I started working in gyms did I not have that lifestyle anymore. And it took about 4 or 5 years, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, here comes psoriasis. And then you share the study with me years down the road, I'm medicating with steroids, doing all these things like that to suppress the psoriasis. Meanwhile, I've got this vitamin D deficiency that should have been fucking obvious, right? Knowing that all that vitamin D is correlated with all almost skin issues, and then it makes so much sense to me that I went from being somebody my entire life that was exposed to tons of sunlight, getting tons of vitamin D, more than my body probably needs, to all of a sudden getting like zero. Yeah. Literally, like, because I would work.
I just got more freckly.
I would get to the gym before the sun came up, and I would work till the sun came down. So, and for years, that's where it was. And then all of a sudden, this comes out.
And vitamin D acts like a hormone in the body, right?
Right. So, so affecting that also.
Oh, all kinds of shit.
Right. And so, for me, then I start supplementing with vitamin D. I noticed it helped suppress my psoriasis. But then I go, like, okay, well, I'm one step better than what I was before. I'm still not like the ideal. The
ideal would be in the sun.
So, yeah. So now I've tried to, and I know that people, our fans, love to hear when we like implement things like this into our life. So, the other day I had to take a call, right? And I was on the phone. It was just a business call, and it was like a 45-minute call. And I was sitting in my living room because I was sitting there on the computer working, and it was still sunny outside. And I'm like, what am I doing? Like, I just stepped right outside, sat in a chair. It was a beautiful day. It was like 75 degrees. Like,
why?
Right. And it felt amazing. And I felt so good afterwards. But just having to retrain myself to think about that, like, wow, how easily I could just kind of cut that out of my life. It was such a part of my life as a child. And you don't think, of course, twice about it. Then I get older. And now, because my body finally has expressed itself and said, fuck you, here's psoriasis for being an asshole and never being in the sun anymore. And then I go talk to Western medicine, and they say, here's a steroid for it. Take some shots. Here's some pills.
Put some cream on it.
Put some cream on it. And then I'm like the whole rest of my life rubbing cream on myself and not realizing that, every time I get stressed out just a little bit about putting the cream on myself, that's flaring it up more anyways. And so playing this game forever. And then it's years later, you hand me a study about vitamin D being correlated to it. And it's like, okay, let me try supplementing. Then, oh my God, oh, I should have just been outside more.
And not to mention the side effects of steroids and creams you had to use,
right?
Which sucks.
It just it blows my mind that you go somewhere like that and they don't even mention that.
But part of it's our fault. Like, how many people do you think, if they went to the doctor and the doctor goes, okay, I'm looking at your lab results right now, here's what you need to do. I want you to exercise 3 days a
sunlight.
Week. You need to get better exercise. Let's go outside at least 20 minutes a day. And
eat
here's your new diet.
Foods.
Yeah, here's your new diet. And then they hand it to them. How many people would do it?
You know, it's crazy. You're right. Even I wouldn't do it. But if you explain to me why I'm supposed to go out and what I'm more than likely.
So
deficient.
You see the flare ups, you're actually going to like take that into consideration.
Right. I think the missing piece, right? And this is why no one does that, because you get 12 minutes with your doctor. So he's fucking blah, 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 and then tells you what to do and then you're off. But instead, if I understood that I have this deficiency, more than likely that's the main reason, right? Whether it be I was genetically predisposed or not, like here I have this deficiency from vitamin D because I'm no longer in the sun. So, hey, you know, I'm going to give you this cream or what about that. But really what you should do is get out and get in the sun as much as you can, because you're deficient in vitamin D, and that's one of your greatest sources of getting vitamin D is that way. And maybe here's some food choices that you should make sure are in your diet, and like, oh, okay, thank you, you know?
It's you know what, though? They do that for certain things. Like when people go to the doctor and they're given a statin or blood pressure medication, I know, because I have family members that go to the doctor, and the doctor will say to them, okay, we're going to have to raise your blood pressure medication, but, you know, if you just lost weight and you exercise, and you wouldn't have to take as much. And you know what they do? Yeah. They go take the fucking...
double dose.
Yeah, they go take more medication.
They're lazy
dude.
As fuck.
And they're my family members.
My family do this.
And I'll tell them, like, this is what you... Listen, you need to work out. You need to write... Nope, no, they don't want
wait
to
hear. A minute. You're healthy? You're taking a bunch of pills. Yeah. So, yeah.
Let me put it this way. They get pissed off when they have to take a pill more than once a day. Yeah. That's too much. Yeah. Do you know how many people go to the doctor and like, what do you mean I got to take it twice a day? Don't you have one I can take once a day? I don't want to have to remember to take it twice.
I want it's the big horse pill.
It's too much work. I have to remember it again.
It's true, dude. Just
gobble it down.
It sucks.
No, it is. It's an uphill battle. Doug, you better bring on that fucking bird.
Being brought to you by Chimera Coffee. It's the only coffee that is infused with all natural nootropics for a cleaner, calmer, and more focused buzz without the crash. Click the Chimera link at mindpumpmedia.com and input the discount code MINDPUMP at checkout for 10% off.
It's the motherfucking quad.
The eagle has landed.
Quee-qua.
All right, first up is X Griffo. Proper way to bulk up. Do you recommend it to build muscle?
So bulking up is the old school way of bulking up is eating a tremendous amount of calories, for a prolonged period of time, gaining lots of weight, because that's what's going to happen, and you get stronger and you build more muscle. There definitely is an anabolic effect from eating more calories. Even people who are sedentary, if they boost their calories, will get initially, there's evidence to show that they'll build a tiny bit of muscle initially, and then they kind of lose that effect. Now that even happens with people who work out. If you dramatically bump your calories initially, you'll get a lot of strength and a lot of muscle gain, but that starts to come down really quick, and then it becomes just fat gain. So that's one thing to consider. The second thing to consider is the best time to do a bulk is right after you do a cut.
Right.
That is an incredible feeling. I have never felt
that contrast.
And I've taken over-the-counter, you know, pro hormones. I've taken all these different things, you know, supplements, whatever. I can't think of a more anabolic muscle-building feeling than going from a cut to a bulk. I mean, it's like, pronounced.
Well, there's so many things that are benefiting you there, like that, why you get that, right? You get this anabolic rebound because you've been in a deficit for several weeks. I wish I would have known this, because my first... you know, fat loss, weight cut ever in my entire life was at fucking 29 years old. Like my whole life I was on the bulk because I was the skinny kid who was always trying to
maintain your muscle mass.
Trying to build muscle. So never in my mind would I ever think, oh, for the next 3 to 4 weeks, I'm going to try and lose weight. That just seems absurd. But had I known what I know now, and had I gone through what I went through in my late 20s, this is what I highly recommend to any of the young hard gainers, and I say that in quotation mark, right? So for anybody who wants to build is to actually first go on a short mini cut for 2 or 3 weeks where you're actually restricting calories and dieting like you're trying to lose, and then going back the other direction.
You'll get such a crazy anabolic effect.
You'll get a crazy anabolic. You'll have lowered your caloric intake that's necessary to bulk and build. Because normally guys that are hard gainers like myself or had a hard time getting enough calories, you know, if I'm constantly feeding, shoveling food, My body's getting used and used to processing that right. much food.
Well, on top of that, would you also suggest like maybe a day of protein fasting? So that way when you come back into the bulk part of it, like you get even more responsive.
Well, yeah, even or intermittently fasting. Like, so what I would do is I would run a, like this is the protocol I would run now. Like if I was the skinny kid trying to bulk up and build muscle, knowing what I know now and understanding physiology the way I do now compared to what I did when in my early 20s, I would cut first for 2 or 3 weeks where I'm pushing as low calorie as my body can handle, where it's relative from where you're at right now, trying to lean out. Because part of what I'm doing by doing that too is your metabolism is going to slow down. Like your leptin's going to get suppressed.
It's the opposite of what we tell people to do when they have a slow metabolism.
Right, right. It's the opposite, right? So I'm kind of trying to do that. I'm trying to, in a sense, kind of slow my metabolism down by cutting, reducing calories. And then I'm going to come back the other way. And when I come back the other way, you reintroduce 500 calories more than wherever your new maintenance is at, and you're going to feel like a fucking champ.
You
right
do,
afterwards.
And in fact,
and you'll put weight on quick.
In fact, when I coach people through bulking now, even through their period of bulking, I have them inject low calorie days. So it's really no different than how I would recommend someone cut. When someone's trying to get leaner,
right, we actually tell them to add calories.
I'll undulate their calories and I'll give them a day or two that are higher calories because I know it helps the metabolism. With someone who's trying to bulk, it's just the reverse, it's the flip. I'll have them most days be in a big surplus, and then there's going to be a day or two where they're actually going to be in a deficit. That's mm-hmm. another way I like to use it. And when people do that, they get more lean body mass and more strength gains from it and less fat gains from it. Yeah. And I know you're listening right now, some of you listening who are thinking, I don't care if I gain some body fat. I'm really skinny. Yeah. No. You would rather gain muscle. That's the point. The point isn't necessarily you don't want to gain fat, although a lot of you don't. The point of it is you'll build more muscle as a result of utilizing
it. If you are not anabolically enhanced and you are trying to do this like everybody else you see on fucking Instagram doing it, you're going to have a hard ass time because what's going to happen is you're going to put on, if you do what they call the dirty bulk or just get big,
just
right?
Eat a bunch of
it's
shit.
It's winter. And this is coming up right now. You're about to see all the
dirty bulk season.
All the Instagram turds are going to start posting their, it's bulk season. Yeah, it's like everybody.
Fruity Pebble pizzas.
Everybody is popping Pop Tarts and we're going to go up 20, 30 pounds because it's winter and it's bulk. Bulk season, and out of that 20 pounds, 16 of it's fat, 4 of it is actually muscle. So you did put some lean mass on. That's why you feel your strength go up and you feel stronger in the gym and you look bigger, you're filling your shirts out. Then you decide you're going to come back the other way and you go to an extreme cut to lose that.
And you're 16, back where you started.
And you're back where you started. And if you're very lucky, you're up 1 pound of muscle. Dude, you've been way better off gradually building it up.
I am speaking from personal experience. Yep. Every year I would get my, so I'm 6 feet tall, right? I walk around about 190 pounds. I used to get my body weight up to between 220 to 230 every winter. Every winter, I would gain 30 to 40 pounds. And then every summer, I'd drop it down and try and get to about 10% body fat, which would be probably anywhere between 190-something, in the mid-190s. Every year, I would do this, and I'd always come back the same. It wasn't like I was gaining muscle every year. It was the same kind of back and forth, and it just wasn't as effective as when I started to learn how to do these mini cuts and mini bulks where I'd go on a two-week deficit and then go in a 4 week surplus. 2 week deficit, 4 week surplus. Of course, overall, surplus is I'm in a surplus more often because my ultimate goal is to gain. But I would always have these deficits because I would notice just tremendous effects when I come out of them, bump up those calories. It would all go to my muscle. In fact, if I got myself really lean, because there's a couple times where I got myself down into like the 5%, 6% body fat range, I would bulk, and for 2 or 3 weeks, I would be shredded still. I would just get bigger. And it was like the most awesome, it's like one of the most awesome feelings. So that's the proper way to bulk. The improper way to bulk is to eat a shit ton of food all the time, consistently, week in, week out. You're going to lose the anabolic effect within a few weeks, and it's just going to become like fat storage.
And not to mention, once as a male, once we get beyond, 15-17% body fat, our testosterone starts to suppress.
It can start to affect it. I think it's around 20%. But
is it? Yeah. I think it's more like 15.
Is it really?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's like 15 for a male, and maybe it's 20, 25 for a female, right? But once you start getting around that 15% plus of body fat for a male, your hormone levels start to dip, which that's the last thing we want to happen if we're trying to build muscle, is to suppress testosterone at all.
Well, fat is a estrogen sensitive hormone, and high amounts of body fat in men act like estrogen, and you'll see estrogenic-like qualities.
Men get boobies.
And they do. They do. So, yep, that's the proper way to bulk. Mini cuts, mini bulks.
We talk about, you know what, we did a YouTube video. You and I did a YouTube video.
We did that. We talked exactly about this.
Yeah. So you should, on Mind Pump TV, you can go find where Sal and I discuss, I think, undulating calories or something.
Now, so what are some of your guys's, like now, right? Now that we know better, what are, because I'm going to actually, I'm going to do a bulk pretty soon. I'm going to do a bulk, a mini bulk, which I haven't done in a while, like a concentrated one. I'm going to do it towards the end of November going into December. I have it all planned out. But the way I do it now is very different. Like the way I used to do it was all calories. Like anything I could eat, I would eat. Mm-hmm. And the more I could eat, the better. Now I'm going to be eating, I'll use things like white rice, buckwheat, which are my two favorite sources of starchy, you know, gluten-free carbohydrates. I'll eat lots of bison or ground beef, grass-fed ground beef. Chicken, tuna, that kind of stuff, avocados, macadamia nuts for my fat sources, just high quality, high calorie foods is what I'll end up eating a lot more of. But I will do more of the starches, buckwheat in particular. I don't know if you guys ever eat buckwheat.
I don't really get buckwheat.
Every buckwheat cereal?
Pancakes.
Yeah.
Do they have buckwheat pancakes?
Yeah, no, Stax does buckwheat pancakes. I've had them. I've had them not that long ago, but it's not something. It's not a regular thing in my diet. I know Thrive Market is where, isn't that where you get yours?
Yes. So they have these buckwheat. I'm gonna look up the name. Maybe Doug can find it for me. The brand that I get, these buckwheat pancakes that are amazing. And so, and I don't put tons of syrup.
What does it call for? So the buckwheat is obviously is replacing the flour. So you're getting the buckwheat, and then what else do you have to add eggs to it or anything like that, or is it literally like?
No, it's
sure
a mix.
That's part of it.
You add water
in the mix.
No,
that's
you just add water.
What?
Yeah. You add water to it.
I think you're making your shit wrong.
No.
Really?
Yes. I showed you guys the other day.
I know you did, but you didn't show me making it though. You didn't have to put eggs, no milk, no nothing in it. You literally just water it, water and the mix.
Mm-hmm.
Really? Yeah.
Yep. And they have ones made with buckwheat. They have some that are paleo, that are made with like almond flour. And is that the one? Arrowhead? Yeah.
Arrowhead.
Yeah. So that's one of them. And then there's another brand that I also eat.
How much is that?
$3.95.
That's it?
Yeah.
Damn.
Retail $5.35.
Yeah. Dude, you know, there's so many companies that are doing this, like at the fitness conventions. Like this is like a big thing, right? Is all the pancake
mixes.
Mix. Oh, yeah, all the mixes. Yeah. They retail them for like $15-$20, dude, for these bags.
Are those because of their protein like base?
Well, or? Yeah. Some of them are, you know, everything's got protein.
That's what I'm saying. Like everything's protein.
So here's the other brand I like. It's Birch Benders. And they have a protein pancake and waffle mix. They have a paleo pancake and waffle mix. And they have a regular one. And my kids love them. But anyhow.
So both brands are on Thrive Market?
Both brands are. So Birch Benders is the other one that I like. Yeah. See, look, that one is really, really good.
Oh, they have a protein one.
Yeah. Look at the protein one and look at the.
Look, even the protein one's $4.79.
$4.79, dude. Okay. At Whole Foods, that's almost $7, by the way.
Yeah.
What I like to do is I'll make these in the morning and I'll just put butter on them and eat them just like that because I don't use syrup.
And they taste good.
Dude, they're fucking great. But I also like just straight up buckwheat that you can make into like a cream of wheat type of cereal. Mm. And it's just, buckwheat is such an easy thing to digest. And if you're listening and you have gut issues and you want to get in more starches because you're either trying to build muscle or get more calories, buckwheat is an excellent source of easily digestible gluten-free carbohydrates.
Man, I'm not using our Thrive Market enough. I didn't realize.
Bro, you need to buy
Everything's in there.
Okay, so the protein one has whey protein in it already there. All you do is add water. So there you go. 16 grams of protein per serving.
Oh, wow, dude.
Yeah, for the protein pancakes. I don't have that one because it's got dairy in it. So
you're such a wuss.
You need to do all your shopping there.
No, I know. I
have me proud.
Katrina has bought a few things on there for us, but I haven't gone on and like really done like what I want to do is, and we're due this week to go hit like our Whole Foods run. Instead of going to Whole Foods, I'm going to order everything, see if we can order everything off.
I want to do that too. I've just been doing condiments and like shampoos and all those types of things. But yeah,
I didn't realize they have that wide of a selection.
Everything.
They even have competitors for similar type stuff too.
Everything you'll find at Whole Foods, you'll find there, except except for the perishables. Like, you're not going to get tomatoes. And stuff
you
like
know
that.
What? I know when we interviewed him, he told, I can't remember how many different products they had. Do you remember the number when he said?
No, it was a lot.
It was a lot. And I'm wondering what that is in comparison to like Whole Foods and some of your normal stores like that. I think they rival that, right?
They're adding them all the time.
Oh, no.
They're up there.
Yeah, that's crazy.
So, well, for the listeners, thrivemarket.com/mindpump, and then you get like all kinds of stuff that I can never remember and that we get in trouble for not remembering. I think it's, what is it, free membership?
You have too much stuff. It's a free membership. You get your first three orders or $20 off each order.
That's $49 or more.
Yeah, $49 or more plus free shipping.
Plus free shipping.
Right. And the way it works, it's a $60 a year membership, similar to like how Costco does it. Mm-hmm. But the cool part is...
You do the Mind Pump code, you get that. It's basically...
Yeah, if you use the Mind Pump code, you get the free month, and then you get $20 off your next three purchases as long as it's over $49. You basically get the money back that you'd have on the membership. So, and what's so awesome that a lot of people don't realize how it works and like how they can get away with being so cheap is that, and getting the product for wholesale, is that there's hardly any margins on the selling of the food. They cut out all the middlemen. And then what they do is that where they make their money is the memberships. You know, their membership is where they make their money. They're not making it on the per item.
It's the Costco model online. So,
yeah, no, it's brilliant with Whole Foods, right? I mean, getting all organic Whole Foods instead of your Costco Kirkland.
Excellent stuff.
Next question is from Talo24. Can you give any insight on how to read studies, what to look for, and how to determine if they are credible?
Well, ask the study man.
Ooh, this is a
ask Google Magic over
study
there.
Study Sal, Professor Sal.
Google Magic. That's like my.
You know what? You
that's
know
like
what,
my name at Burning
you
Man.
You know what was funny was today.
Google Magic.
It's Google Magic. It's so shiny.
You never cease to amaze me with some of the things that you're able to recall. I mean, for the listeners, literally, I walked in this morning. One of the books, audiobooks I'm listening to right now is called Subliminal. And I came in to like, I told Sal, I said, man, you would love this book. It's about the unconscious mind and the conscious mind. And they totally cite all these studies. And I start to tell a study and he finishes the rest of the study. And I was just like, this motherfucker, I can't even one up you on this. Like, I don't know how you remember these studies. And do you have a source that you go to that's your go-to spot, or are you all over?
This is all PubMed. Like, what are we talking about here?
So I think I've been thinking about this, and I think most of us have this ability. It's just for things that we find super compelling.
So I wasted mine on baseball cards?
Well,
fuck!
Well, think about it this way.
I wasted like,
Think of your hobbies and the things you really love to do the most. You probably know like the different names of whatever, whether it's cars or shoes or clothes or TV shows or quotes from a particular actor or whatever. For me, it's just for whatever reason, it's studies. And there was no value in it whatsoever until I got a podcast. So thank God we have a podcast. Now I can use this totally worthless.
Found your purpose.
Yeah, it was cool at like parties and stuff, and that was it.
It's a party. You know, just see him up there with like a smoker's jacket, just, hey guys. I want to tell you about this microbiome study.
I read 3 years ago.
PubMed.
I tell you.
Huh? Anybody? Like, where'd everybody go?
Great way to pick up on girls. Yeah. Hey, did you know blue eyes didn't show up until 30,000 years ago? And what? Oh, my God.
Please share that. That's the truth. That's true, isn't it?
Yeah.
They called you pussy.
So, no. This, I've heard this before. Okay, so blue eyes weren't always around.
No. It's a relatively new, I don't know how long ago it was. Maybe it was 30,000 years ago, but it's a relatively new, in the whole scheme of things,
so
variation.
What are the common colors? Do you remember all this stuff?
No, I don't remember that. I know brown.
Oh yeah,
it's the most common one. I don't know. Like, and again, it's random. I'll remember random shit. It's not directed. You know what I'm saying? I can't direct it. So here's the thing with studies.
Bits and pieces.
This is a good question because you see a lot of sensationalized articles on your social media that will say things like, red wine, you know, boost fat loss.
Super biased and stuff.
Yeah, eat chocolate if you want to, you know, gain muscle, or a compound in chocolate was found to prevent Alzheimer's or whatever. Yeah. And so you'll read these headlines and you're going to be like, oh shit. And then you share it and you're like, dude, check out the study. It's freaking awesome. What you need to do is you need to look into the study and look at a few things.
Controls.
Number one, look at the sample size. So that means how many people are in the study.
Yeah, there's four people. It's
irrelevant.
You see studies like that.
You could pick four random people and just by chance pick four similar people who are then going to skew the fuck out of a study, or even 10 people. Like if I took 10 people from a gym and I sampled them and I asked them fitness questions, the answers I'm going to get aren't going to really be representative of the population,
right?
Because the
five out of six doctors
less than
agree.
Half the population is working out, so you're not even addressing half of
that's
our,
it. Yeah. Here's it, and most studies, I hate to say this, most studies are done on males between, I believe, the ages of like 20 to 30, like college age or a little older males, white males. So that alone,
we're the ones willing to experiment.
Well, willing to experiment.
Test on me.
In college, as projects. So that's another part that people don't understand about studies is most studies that we see that are actually get promoted and put out there that are biased, it's because they're expensive to do. Yeah. And so it's not like we're running around doing all these great studies on stuff. So when you do see one, 9 times out of 10,
it's funded by someone.
It's funded by a company that it already had a desired outcome before they went into the fucking study. So it's as biased as it comes.
Yep, and you can tweak data however you want.
I used to tell clients all the time, I'm like, give me any topic you fucking have heard about with health, fitness wise, nutrition wise, I'll sell you on both sides of it.
Yeah.
I'll sell you how it's the worst thing for you ever, and I'll sell you how it's the best thing in the world.
So you want
to
look
to spin the data.
So sample size is important. How many people are in the study? Is it double blind? In other words, double blind meaning the study participants don't know that they're the ones that are being, you know, either the control group or the tested group. So in other words, they don't know if they're getting the active ingredient when they're taking the supplement or pill or whatever. It could be whatever. The people giving the test don't know either. That's important because we know that
it can
have an influence. So double blind meaning nobody knows who's getting what. So it's this big guess. The only people knowing are at the end of the study who are getting the data. Then there's placebo controlled. Placebo controlled means if we're going to give someone. If I'm going to test something like an herb like turmeric and I'm looking at inflammation and I've got 500 people, I'm going to give 250 of them turmeric and the other 250...
nothing at all that's related
something
to
that looks like turmeric but isn't. You know, like here's this pill and it's got like sugar in it or something like that. And because...
which is a very bad example because if you're testing for inflammation and you gave sugar pills...
Wow, these
you would
levels...
inflame-
That's skyrocketing.
That's a good point.
What the hell's going on in there?
I just got to call you out because if you me on that one for sure.
Yeah. Wow. Looks like turmeric lowers blood sugar.
Heroin. That's everybody asleep.
Yeah. So that's important. Double blind, placebo controlled. You want to see if it's peer reviewed. In other words, has it been reviewed by other people in this field? And then look at the consensus of studies. There's meta analysis where they'll take many studies on this subject and you're going to see this general trend, because one study will point you in a direction, but rarely is one study conclusive. It's typically going to tell you, oh wow, looks like, you know, people who take multivitamins tend to live longer. Let's do more studies.
And rarely ever can they duplicate a study exactly the same. So many times, even like the best studies is like, okay, take this in generals, right?
Well,
like in general speaking, this is what it's like.
Each time there's new variables.
It's interesting you say that. So when they make the study as close to as the previous studies possible and they try to mirror it, even then... there's a large minority, but it's not a majority, but still a large percentage. I forgot what it was, something like 20% or something, that are not able to be duplicated. So they'll take, what I mean by that is they'll do the same study and the results are different. So they can't find the same results that were found with the first study. That percentage goes up with psychological based studies or behavioral studies. Behavioral studies, I think something like 40% of them they can't be duplicated. They can't mimic them. So they'll find like, oh, people who listen to this music tend to act this particular way or whatever.
Well,
then they copy the study, comes out totally.
Well,
different.
now you're getting me excited because this is exactly what I was reading this morning with Subliminal. They talk about that's because like 95% of the information that our brain is downloading is unconscious. Like we're only like this. There's only a small percentage is actually conscious that you're doing. Your eyes are downloading information, absorbing, take it in. So it's so easy for that to manipulate and make you biased on your decisions. So when you talk about behavioral science and stuff, this is where this gets crazy.
Even with movement, right? They say that like, are you really in control of your movement, or does your movement happen and then you perceive it right afterwards?
Well, and you could be walking into the study and somebody says something to you that has nothing to do with the study right before, and it could influence and change how you react to certain questions.
I'll give you an example. Mm-hmm. So, and you're right, and the brain can be primed to think certain things on axis. So I'll give you guys an example. I want you right now to imagine the color gray. Just imagine the color gray. Now, really quick, think of an animal. And it's likely that you thought of an elephant.
Yep.
Very likely. So I primed
I almost
you
with, said donkey. Yeah. But yeah.
It's very, very likely reasons. That you thought of an elephant. And it's just, there's lots of these tricks that happen in the brain.
We use this in sales. We use this in sales with leading questions, right? When you're leading people into a sale and a close and tying them down by getting them, you're priming them to say yes, right? Like,
dude, that's what magicians do all day. Yeah, they put an idea in your head and they're like, oh.
So fun. But yeah, as far as studies are concerned, they can direct you. Look at the consensus. Look at the controls. That's another one. How did they control the study? I love to give this example because it's a classic one. It wasn't that long ago, probably 30 years ago or so, that coffee was thought to cause to be a carcinogen. So it was thought that coffee was bad for you because the studies done on coffee drinkers showed that they had a higher rate of cancer. The problem was in these studies, they never controlled for cigarette smoking. Yep. And 30 years ago, people who drank lots of coffee also smoked a lot of cigarettes. Ah. So it's just a basic example. You want to look at controls. How are they controlling the studies? Look at all these things and then start to kind of form an opinion. But I also don't want to throw out anecdote. Although anecdote is not evidence, a lot of anecdote points to different directions. And thankfully, because we have technology, we have the internet, we can go on forums, we can read what people are saying, and you can kind of figure things out before studies come out. For example, you know, people have been talking about how artificial sweeteners affect their gut poorly way before the recent studies showing that it negatively affects the gut microbiome. People have been talking about how, you know, certain things will affect inflammation in a positive way before studies come out saying, oh yeah, they're absolutely right. Eating these particular foods or whatever has good effects on inflammation. So those are all the things you want to consider. But
or just fucking read Sal's Instagram page.
There you go. Yeah. I never quote
follow
study,
Sal.
I never put down the study either. People get so mad.
Oh, okay.
What's great. The source?
Why?
Yeah, I get mad when people ask Google. That. Expect that. You know, go do your work. He spent 40 years of his life fucking doing it. You should do it too.
Here's I research. Yeah, tell me. That's just lazy.
All right, next is Mick the Plant Man. You guys talk about cardio not being a great component of longevity, and Ben Greenfield has shared how triathlon training has significantly decreased his telomere length. With that being said, how are these 60-plus-year-olds crushing it?
Tell Ben Greenfield I don't give a shit about his fucking telomeres. Fuck you, Ben.
It's a hot topic.
Yeah, right,
so,
dude.
So
I'll tell you what my telomeres are doing.
So here, this is a great topic.
I have no idea.
Now, telomeres are at the end of your DNA, and we can they are a good signal for aging. So if you have your biological age, and then your telomere will tell you your you know, how old your body is in terms of, its health or whatever.
You know, I feel like before you go further in the science here, I feel like there's going to be a very fine line here that you're talking about. Like, you could easily overdo that and have adverse effects from it, too, from other parts from the running all the time. So you may have some benefits that show, like, oh, for longevity, this part of running.
What he's saying is, so Ben Greenfield talked about a decrease, meaning when he trained for a triathlon, his body aged more rapidly.
I thought he was saying
No.
That makes way more sense. I was thinking just
sorry, like, Ben. I was talking shit to you.
No. It decreased.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
That makes perfect sense.
That doesn't conflict with what we've said.
No. And I don't think he's saying that. I think he's just saying, knowing what we say about cardio, knowing what Ben Greenfield said, why is it that we see these 60-plus-year-olds who are crushing it in these competitions?
Well, what's your goal? That doesn't make sense to me.
They're efficient at that movement.
Why'd you pick this question?
This
is not a very good question.
Let me tell you
what's wrong with it. One, we agree with that with Ben, like absolutely. Yeah. And you can be 60 years old and crushing your sport. I mean, we talk about this all the time. Like, that doesn't mean...
Well, this is important because...
It doesn't mean optimal health.
Thank you. It's important.
What do they look like?
This is important because...
Skinny raisin.
Well, eating...
That's what they look like.
Eating and
you
training.
You run that much. Show me somebody who's been running for fucking 60 years.
It is kind of raisin-esque.
Tell me somebody who's been... show me a picture of somebody who's been running for 60-plus years, okay?
Getting closer to
that doesn't
death.
Look like a fucking skinny raisin. Yeah. That's what they look like. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's oxidative stress.
And it's not just that all skinny raisin people run very long. That's not the correlation here. It's fucking that when you do that...
It makes you look like that.
Yeah, it's what makes you look like.
So, skinny raisin disease. So here's the thing.
It's a thing.
Hashtag.
That's a new hashtag we're starting.
Training and eating for maximum longevity is not the same as training and eating for maximum performance, and vice versa. No. If you train and eat to maximize your performance, especially for stamina-based and endurance-based sports, you are going to be taking away from longevity. That's a fact. So I hate to say that, but if you're, you know, you're kind of, you got to balance the two. Now, if you're a competitive athlete, this is your livelihood.
Well,
do your thing. If you're an everyday person that just wants to be fit and healthy, this is something you should look at because, you know, I could push my body and squeeze out another 5 pounds of muscle on it. Is it worth reducing my longevity and overall wellness?
Right,
no,
right.
It's not, because 5 pounds isn't that fucking big of a difference anyway.
Yeah.
Same thing with taking 30 seconds off of your marathon time or whatever. So, you know, consider those two things. Longevity is very different. In fact, when they do studies on the world's blue zones, this is where people live. You have a disproportionate amount of people who live to 100 or older, more so than the rest of the world. All of their activity, everything they do, revolves around moderation.
Yeah.
It's all consistent daily, moderate, low to
the
moderate
intensity of their movement. Yeah, it's moderate. Yeah, everything.
They don't. None of them are hardcore exercisers. Yeah. None of them are competing in powerlifting. None of them are running marathons and doing CrossFit. No. They're all just.
They're very chill.
That's it. They're chill. They're active appropriately. They challenge themselves kind of a little bit on a daily basis, but nothing extreme or hardcore. So yeah, training hardcore like these 60-year-olds that are crushing it. They're
crushing it. They're crushing their back.
And they've got the benefit of, you know, they probably eat healthy and they move, so they've got the benefit of that, but then they've got the detriment of overdoing it. So when they're not going to necessarily live to their 90 or something, they're probably going to live to their, you know, like the normal age life expectancy that the average person gets to who doesn't exercise and doesn't eat right. See what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah. No. I think that, and I think somebody who's been running, like, and I know we tease the runners all the time on here, right? Like we're anti running.
Poor runners.
I just think that there's so many people in the running camp that think it's the best thing for your body because maybe they've been in the best shape of their lives while they're running, and I think that's mainly where we're always trying to address to people. It's like, no, and I definitely think that somebody who decides to run and make healthy choices of eating is far better off than the couch potato who never exercises and eats potato chips all day long. Like, yeah, if we're comparing those two, absolutely, I'd rather see somebody run themselves to death than somebody sit and eat themselves to death on the couch. The person running themselves to death will probably outlast the person sitting on the couch and eating themselves to death. But both of them are not heading in the best way for longevity for yourself, and that's just the bottom line. Mm-hmm. But performance is different than longevity.
Yeah, and there's quality of life. Like these 60-year-olds who are killing it in triathlon competitions, they probably love what they're doing. They're probably having a lot of fun doing
it.
Right. They're having a blast. You know, okay, that's cool. Do your thing, man. Like, you know.
I love ice cream. Yeah, I mean, whatever.
Terrible analogy.
Next.
Our next question is from T. Fluitt. Top 5 most functional lifts.
Oh. Yeah, here we go. Let's start with number 1.
Squat, for sure.
What is the number 1 most functional lift? I think we're all going to say squat, right?
Right.
Yeah. I wonder if we're going to disagree on all
one.
Of these.
I don't think we'll disagree on any, but I think everybody will have
order.
One.
You weigh out.
Oh, the order. You want to go in order?
Weigh out.
Yeah, let's go in order. Okay. So most functional lift?
Squat.
It's got to be the squat.
For sure.
What do you think the second most functional lift is? Deadlift?
I'm going to go.
Overhead press.
I'm going to go with Zercher. Think about functionality, everyday behaviors.
I see where you're going with that. Yeah.
How often do you walk around in a front-loaded carry situation where you have to pick something up off the ground or grab? Right. To me,
well, they're so similar.
I know. But if you're going in order, one, then two, like that, I feel like
you'll outrank deadlift.
Then you take that box and put it up on the shelf.
Deadlift is
overhead pressing.
Deadlift is my third. Overhead press is my fourth.
Okay, because I would go barbell squat. Deadlift, then I would go overhead press, then I would go bench press, and then here's the problem with number 5. I want to throw something in there that's
like a lunge,
rotational though, because everything's so like, you know.
Well, you could do a rotational lunge or a multi-planar lunge, and now you're killing it.
Yeah, I would say that. Or what about some kind of a row or a pull up?
Well, no, you get your deadlift in there.
I guess.
Yeah, you got your deadlift in there. I don't know. To me, I go squat. I think we all agree on squat. I go Zercher squat, even though they're similar. I still think that you got to get a front-loaded, holding something type of exercise. Yeah. Whether you do,
it's a good point.
You could combine the Zercher with a multi-planar lunge, get real functional here.
Yeah,
you know, like well, you want, you know, like After you hit the big three or so, I feel like it's kind of like you could debate.
Well, I would say goblet squat is very similar to just Zercher squat, right? Because it's like you're holding something in, but you're trying to keep. Like, you're not really going to be lifting anything that's like much bigger than your body.
Well, how about this? Let's go this way. What are the most functional or foundational movements? Because we can name like a Zercher and a deadlift, they're both kind of hip hinging, right?
Like just the patterns.
Yeah, like what do they say they are? There's like they're squatting, There's pushing horizontally, pushing overhead, there's pulling horizontally, pulling from overhead. You've got rotation, split stance position, you know, movements.
Unilateral
type movements, kind of lateral type movements.
You'd have to have something rotational in there. So that's probably the only thing that we missed by all of us, because you got to have something that's so we're not stuck in the sagittal plane the entire time. So
what would you?
Yeah, well, I like Cossack, but it's not like, I mean, it's very functional, but it's not like a staple. You know, I give everybody.
Here's something controversial that I think we'll agree on, but maybe some people will freak out a little over. What's more functional, overhead press or a bench press?
Overhead press.
Yeah.
All day.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of people are going to argue with that because it's part of the big three.
Who argues with that?
Just the simple fact that one of them, you're lying down on a bench and you can take half of your body out of the equation already makes it. That's not even a debate to me. True. Like if someone tries to debate
you're
that.
You're not stabilizing your spine like the same way. It's just like, yeah,
anything standing that you're having to do with your feet planted on the ground is going to become more functional than anything
and
else.
And I see it being way more functional in all sports.
Which is also why I thought the whole stability ball craze of standing on the stability ball and stuff like that is funny that we call that functional, because how often will you ever stand on a fucking round ball that's about to roll somewhere?
If you're in the circus.
Right, exactly. Yeah. If you were in the circus, that's a functional movement. Otherwise, not very functional.
Yeah, back in the day, that was a test of strength, was overhead press. It wasn't. Bench press came in later, much later.
The bent press.
Yeah, that's a great one. You want a rotational.
Yeah, let's add the bent press for the
rotational.
So there
you go. There's your rotational, overhead strength, and hip hinge all in one. I mean,
I like that one.
Did we make a bent press video for YouTube?
Yeah, Justin did.
Did I do
one?
A long time ago.
At the other gym.
Yeah. Oh, good. So you can go to our YouTube channel and look up the bent press. It is an old school, extremely functional movement.
Old-timey.
For you bodybuilder types or people who like to develop your muscles.
Mind pump TV.
It'll give you incredible back and delt development.
Watch your back, It's a delicate movement if you haven't rotated like that before.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.